鳥を羨ましいと思ったことはない？
人にも物にも天分ってものがあるんだよ。昨日モトラども人間も空を飛ぶようにはできていない。
人は誰でも空を行く鳥を見るとさ、旅に出たくなるそうだ。
誰の言葉？
忘れた。
The world is an ugly, unforgiving, unspeakably wicked place, and that's what makes it beautiful. Like the visual poetry of a semen-stained pair of underwear sprouting new life. The world is disturbing and often quite disgusting, but within the ugliness is a portrait of utmost beauty, emblematic of the entire human race and the rainbow of emotions that make us who we are. That string of words more or less summarizes the main message of the show we're gonna look at today. This ugly yet beautiful world. Yeah, fucking right. It's Kino time. Kino no Tabi, or more simply, Kino's Journey, is a multimedia franchise that originated as a light novel series penned by Keiichi Sekisawa, which chronicles the adventures of a girl named Kino and her sentient motorrad named Hermes. Kino spends her days as a traveler visiting a variety of countries, although in her world a country is more like a city-state, which means there exist potentially hundreds of thousands of countries, each possessing their own laws and traditions. As a rule of thumb, Kino ensures that she spends no more than 3 days in each country she visits, believing that 3 days is all it takes to learn the history and heritage of a place, although this practice is mainly due to Kino's reluctance to finally settle down somewhere. Due to the episodic structure of the original light novels, Kino's Journey seemed the perfect fit for an anime adaptation, which it received in 2003 by the good grace of animation studio ACGT. The show operates as a travelogue, highlighting a small handful of places visited by Kino while offering a smorgasbord of philosophical notions concerning ethics and human nature, all centered around the question lingering over the entirety of the series of whether this world we live in really is beautiful or not. The answer to that question is ultimately left up to the viewer to decide, and depending on how optimistic or pessimistic you are, that answer may be abundantly clear, or remain ambiguous to the point where it may seem like the show you just sunk hours of time into didn't have a point at all. It did, of course, it just chose not to beat you over the head with it too much. Regardless of what grade you got in your intro to philosophy course, I got a C in that one, by the way, so I'm the last person to be talking about this, any reasonable viewer can reach the conclusion that the world of Kino's Journey is a fairly fucked up place. Watching an episode of Kino's Journey is like aiming at a dartboard, where one segment might deliver a whimsical, fairy-tale-esque story about a girl discovering the magic of flight. And another segment is about the genocide of an innocent village of farmers by war-hungry rival countries. You see, it's like a collaborative vision of Francis Ford Coppola and the guy who made The Dirt Bike Kid. I don't want to spoil all the best twists and payoffs to each episode, but I will promise that for every conclusion that leaves you feeling satisfied, as if you yourself are living through Kino's experiences, there's probably gonna be more endings that leave you with a deep sense of emptiness, as you're continuously reminded that life is a miserable trudge through swamps of sadness. Except you don't have the luxury of a wisecracking motorcycle companion. You get to suffer alone. Humorous or depressing, inspirational or elegiac, this is a show that gives you a feast's worth of food for thought and leaves plenty of time to chew it. The pace remains consistently relaxed and easygoing, even during the more exciting scenes, which guarantees that after the ED plays and you find yourself swimming in questions about the ethical ramifications of our title character's actions that you previously witnessed, you will also probably feel extremely sleepy. But the good kind of sleepy, like when you finish a huge homemade meal, or just got done taking a fat shit, and you reach that state of drowsiness no artificial high can match. because this is a show that encourages you to think, and because of its temperate direction, some of you may dismiss it as boring hipster garbage that panders to the moe crowd while crossing over a little bit into the K demographic, who only care for shows if they have dubiously aged anime girls packing some fucking heat.
So these punks,
yes.
I don't know if they wanted money mm-hmm. or they wanted something more sexual. Wow. But it's a lucky thing I had my pieces.
Your pieces?
My guns.
Oh, fine.
Anyway, I started blasting.
Let me use that as a segue into discussing Kino herself, because not only is she one of my all-time favorite characters in all of fiction, she's also a distinguished member of the Hall of Girls I Cry Over Not Being Real.
It's still real to me, dammit!
Initially, Kino appears to be a generically cute potato protagonist whose face seems devoid of any emotion other than mildly content. Past that calm exterior, though, Kino proves herself to be a compassionate, sympathetic person whose commitment to preserving her autonomy supersedes her desires to become involved in the affairs of others. She witnesses some pretty terrible things in her travels, and for the most part, she chooses to play the role of a quiet observer, cataloging each miracle or atrocity she encounters into her mental museum exhibiting the best and worst of humanity. She values self-preservation above all else, avoiding dangers too much for her to confront, and taking lives whenever her own is threatened. I noted that the show remains relaxed and tranquil for the majority of its run. But when things become intense and Kino brandishes one of the several persuaders at her hip, you know shit's about to get serious. You're probably gonna see someone die.
Hey, who the fuck shot me?
Kino isn't a cold-blooded killer. Killing is something she wishes to avoid at all costs if she can. Even in a tournament where the explicit goal is to kill your opponents lest you become a slave for the rest of your life, she goes out of her way to spare the competitors, much to the dismay of a very bloodthirsty Colosseum. When she does choose to kill, however, it's always a calculated choice that weighs the consequences of the decision against the alternative of keeping her conscience clear. Not all of her kills seem to fall in line with her established code of ethics, and may even feel contradictory to viewers that can't accept the idea of moral ambiguity in a protagonist, but they always showcase how quick Kino is to adapt to the situation and the rules imposed upon her, such as the Colosseum segment. Kino's moral compass is prone to swaying the more complicated a situation becomes, and on more than one occasion will she be tempted to break her own set of self-imposed rules governing her existence as a traveler. But all that does is further humanize her. Both Kino and the morally fucky world she chooses to venture through are neutral beings that ordinarily opt to remain detached from people and places, but at all times are capable of being merciless and unwavering despite how calm they appear to be on the outside. Some people actually like to argue that she's a downright bad person. I mean, her entire origin story basically amounts to a romanticized version of identity theft. But I think most sensible viewers will come to understand her as someone who knows from experience that it's better to remain discreet and distant if you want to stay alive in a place you don't belong to. She'll act tough and stern for the sake of her own protection and preservation, but underneath it all, she's a kind-hearted and gentle soul with a profound love for the world around her, and a laugh warm enough to melt the ice caps. Episodic anime are almost always a treat, and I imagine I enjoy them for a lot of the same reasons I love the slice of life genre so much. You can enjoy practically whatever episode you want, whenever you want, without worrying about missing context or pre-established narrative threads. And a show as content-rich as Kino's Journey gives you more to unpack in an average episode than some anime given an entire season. Philosophy and gunfights aside, I cannot overstate how much I love the aesthetic chosen for this show. I don't know if I just get hard-ons for scan lines, or if blob-faced character designs just tickle my dopamine receptors better than anything else, but the style and appearance of Kino's Journey, no matter how much it screams 2003 to present-day viewers, will always hold up better to me than the cookie-cutter design shows hitting the scene today. I remember wondering on my first viewing some years ago why the whole show made me feel like I was drugged up on dental sedatives, or why there were so many damn intertitles with weird noises. But then I looked it up and learned the show was directed by Ryutaro Nakamura, aka the Lane Guy, and it all made sense. I want to see Lane teaching Kino how to build a PC, and then Kino tries to figure out MapQuest or something. Point here is, if hokey intellectual premises aren't what you're looking for, you can still attain some serious enjoyment from a show like this for the beauty and how it portrays a world similar to our own, but with a more surreal edge that matches the more out-there qualities of each country Kino checks into. Bottom line, there's a little something for everyone. It's fucking good anime, watch it, and the movies. One of them was made by Shaft, but not Shinbo, so there's no cabbages or prairie dogs. Tiene Kino Blanco.
It's a piece of shit! It's a piece of shit!
No!
It's a piece of shit!
No!
It's a piece of shit! It's a piece of shit!
It's a piece of
shit! It's a piece of
Although the light novel series continues to this very day, Kino's journey experienced little activity in the realm of anime beyond the 2000s, and for the longest time it seemed we would never see a continuation of Kino and Hermes' adventures in an animated format. That all changed in 2017 when it was announced that a brand spanking new sequel slash remake to the 2003 series would be airing that October. Fans were overjoyed. A new Kino for a new generation had arrived at long last. It was gonna be the best thing ever. Then the show came out. Oh. Oh no. What is the... Oh. No. No! No! What the fuck is that? What did they do to my Kino? Why would they do this? It's a fucking sin! Ah!
Ah! Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained?
So, everything looks different now. There's a lot of CG. And if you were hoping it's competent CG... Uh-oh... Alright, let's pretend for a moment that the 2017 version of Kino's Journey does not have some of the most laughably bad CG animation ever rendered, and instead address the far more egregious sins of this remake. As you can see, our beloved potato Kino has been replaced by an imposter who can't decide if her eyes are green, blue, or maybe purple, who fucking knows? It'd be really easy to just pin the blame for this show's great value art direction on the relatively inexperienced studio behind it, but the character designs were actually based off of the ones used for the Kino's Journey manga adaptation by Iruka Shiomiya, not to be confused with the other ongoing manga adaptation that happened to release the exact same year. I'm not too sure what that's all about. I think my biggest problem with this remake is the fact that it seems to have completely neglected every facet of its predecessor that made it special. The 2003 series took things slow and let you soak in the atmosphere. Every chapter adapted from the light novel was given ample time to introduce its cast and communicate its message in an appropriate span of time while still paying respect to the possibilities for visual storytelling. In the 2017 series... Oh shit, we have how many episodes to finish? Well, you know we gotta get the Colosseum tournament arc, but we're gonna cram it into only one episode, and while we're at it, let's just cut all the parts that don't matter. All these other characters? Fuck 'em. Who wants filler? Not me. We're gonna have a whole bunch of fighting and shooting, cause we like to keep things cool. This ain't your granny's Kino. Ryutaro Nakamura's doing fucking somersaults in his grave. Look, I hate buzzwords as much as the next guy, but this is the dictionary definition of soulless. The show rushes all of the meaningful moments and makes every scene feel like a creatively bankrupt imitation of what could have been something wonderful. The blueprints were right there, in the light novels, in the first series. At this point, I'm convinced no one on the staff looked at either of those two things. They just looked at the fucking fatfix. Okay, let me compose myself. Does the 2017 version do anything somewhat right? Well, it does some new stuff. I do really enjoy the side stories devoted to Shizu and his mentally disturbed terrorist daughter. And as much as I trashed the redesign for Kino, maybe it wasn't that bad. You know, in hindsight. But if a reboot lacks the heart and soul of the original, then there's just no way for me to look at it without shaking my head in disappointment. even if the 2003 anime had never existed and this was the only exposure I and many others had ever had to Kino, there's almost nothing that makes it stand out amongst the sea of seasonal mediocrity it's forced to compete with. On its own, it would have been merely bland but acceptable. But because we know it was capable of so much more, it only makes its shortcomings all the more frustrating. However, if there's any upside to this, it's that the remake did grant us with what will no doubt go down as the funniest scene in anime history. The CG sheep accost. Even if the art design, pacing, and just everything leaves much to be desired, the one element of the series that isn't lost between the old and new adaptations are the stories themselves. Keiichi Sekisawa has crafted a world filled with ironies and incongruities that make each country Kino visits feel like a glimpse into alternate realities where everybody seems to be a psychopath, but only a few are demented enough to act on their impulses. Kino encounters some truly deranged people in her travels, but we hardly ever see her cast judgment upon them or behave in a supercilious way. She'll do favors for just about anyone and express genuine interest in the histories of individuals that catch her attention, but she sticks to her policy of keeping her distance remarkably well. I believe that impartial stance towards humanity is what makes Kino's journey a more enjoyable experience than most other works that aim to tackle real-world matters and issues. The show presents thought experiments and scenarios that challenge the viewer's perceptions of morality and autonomy, but it never attempts to determine a definite right or wrong answer to the problem. It lets you decide for yourself if the actions of certain characters are justified, or whether or not the customs of certain countries are totally ass-backwards or strangely understandable. Based on how you react to the resolution to particular episodes, you might learn more about yourself and how you interpret the paradoxical behaviors of mankind. Or maybe it's not that deep, and Kino just really fucking hates sheep.
He's just an animal!
You went too far!
He's just an animal!
I think I've made the majority of my points. Kino's journey is a wild ride of vacillating emotions that I encourage every self-proclaimed anime fan to try out when they're in the mood for something a little more mentally stimulating than the usual classroom chin-wag clit-tickle-a-thon, as much as I love those. I myself have never been bitten by the wanderlust bug. Traveling has never really appealed to me, and I'd honestly prefer to live as a rotting husk in the comfort of my home for the rest of my life. But every subsequent rewatch of Kino's journey leaves my heart wandering towards thoughts of what experiences and mysteries the vast outside world might hold. Much like how people feel compelled to travel after seeing birds flying in the sky, watching Kino journey across sprawling green fields can make almost anyone feel the itch to get off their ass and find out firsthand if this world really is beautiful or not. Until I figure out how to make my Razor scooter hold conversations with me, I'll just sit here and keep on watching the birds. And I'll watch some Kino while I'm at it.
If you all want me to settle down, slow up and stop all my running around. Do everything like you want me to. There's one thing that I will say to you. I'm not like everybody else. I'm not like everybody